is going to be presented by Dr. Yuko Shimizu, who is now associated with Meiji Gakuen University. Her paper is titled The Impact of Christianity on Early and Modern Japan. Please take away. Thank you.
In this presentation, I will discuss the acceptance of Christianity in Japan in the 16th and 17th centuries. The objective is to argue about the significance of the Christian missionaries in this period, not only in terms of Japanese history, but also world history. With regard to the latter point, I refer to the significance of the missionaries in the epoch of the world of the earth. As Keiji Yamaguchi argued, the world of the earth refers to a new era of economic and political links on a global scale, made possible by the expansion of trade. And the first topic is the acceptance of Christianity in Japan. Christian missionaries first arrived in Japan in 1549, and in less than half a century, the missionaries area expanded rapidly, extending from Ezo to this Hokkaido to Kyushu Island, thus encompassing nearly the whole country. Moreover, in Japan, unlike in China and Korea, people of all classes accepted Christianity. Based on the annual reports by the Jesuits, we can calculate the proportion of Christians within the Japanese population at the end of the 17th century. It was 4.4%. This is significantly higher than the commonly estimated present figure of approximately 1%. It is also said that at least 4,000 Christians were martyred in Japan. This indicates that the Japanese did not just superficially accept Christianity. Let's consider the reasons why the missionaries succeeded in Japan. First, the Jesuits had a policy of accommodatio, not compulsion as seen, for instance, in South America. Alessandro Bargnano, who led the Japanese missionaries, decided to undertake this policy because he observed that Japanese people wanted to accept Christianity by their own volition. In this situation, accommodatio was a more effective policy. As a part of the accommodatio policy, in 1519, Bargnano introduced a press machine to publish textbooks for Japanese Christians. Several students about the use of these textbooks have been conducted, and it has been found that they were utilized mainly by the upper class. However, there is little information about how illiterate people were able to grasp this new religion. Therefore, many researchers doubt whether the lower classes really understood the doctrine of Christianity. For example, one researcher focusing on underground Christians, most of whom were farmers or fishermen, claims that Christianity was mixed up with Buddhism and Shintoism, a phenomenon that he believes began in the 16th century. I disagree with this opinion, however, because there is little agreement on the case of undergrad Christians in Urakami. There are some documents that demonstrate that their identity as Christians during the Edo period was clear, and they had a relatively appropriate knowledge of the doctrine. In my opinion, one of the reasons for this awareness as Christian is because some printed books were more easily accessible in Urakami than elsewhere after the persecution by the Tokugawa government. Actually, some literate Christians holding these books succeeded to convey their doctrines to others during the Edo period. It should also be added that the faith of lower class people needed to be considered weak. Even Barignano told his subordinates, "You should be careful not to spend too much effort converting farmers due to the lack of firmness that they have." With the change of laws, they recede easily, and there is a great difficulty in converting them. However, it would be unfair to evaluate the strength of their faith on this observation, because in some regions, Christian laws had forced the people to convert to Christianity. In addition, in my understanding, all upper-class samurais, with very few exceptions, gave up the Christian faith when prohibitive laws were announced by the Toyotomi and Tokugawa government. This shows that class was not necessarily relevant in assessing strength of faith. The question now arises, what were the factors that moved people to accept and maintain the Christian faith? Why did they feel that they could not abandon it, even though their faith posed a risk to their lives? The second topic the reasons for acceptance. The first point to note is that the Japanese people originally placed strong hopes in the idea of salvation, which Christian soteriology was able to address well. Let's take the example of the Tochirina Kirishita. Catechetical book published by the Jesuits for Japanese people in 1591. This book was modeled on another catechetical text for children written by the Jesuit Padre Marco Giorgi and first published in 1566 in Lisbon. This is another edition published in 1602. I have obtained the first edition, unfortunately. When one compares the first chapter to both texts, the following sentences can be found only in the Japanese version. If you do not worship this Koikitai, Koikitai is God, you will not be saved after death. The human being has not only body, but also endless anima. This anima gives life to the body, and the body will never end, even if it becomes salt or ash. Furthermore, it is interesting that the Japanese translation can be interpreted differently from the original text. For example, the translator explains that the term the gospel means a known and true way of salvation after death. We can recognize from all these modifications what Japanese people expected from Christianity. Salvation was a serious topic for Japanese people in this period. For example, Ikoshimoto, a group of lay devotees of the Jōshin sect of Buddhists, fought against the secular forces with a slogan, we will go to heaven if we advance, or endless hell if we withdraw. Thus, the matter of salvation had relevance not only during one's lifetime, but also after this. However, the commentary regarding salvation after death was contradictory among Buddhism sects. With regard to this, what the Christian missionaries propagated had gravity and demonstrated concrete ways to save this idea. Second, the idea of God as a creator of all nature was persuasive for the Japanese people. This is a very important point, because the missionaries told the people that they could not achieve salvation except by believing in the Creator. Arimichi Erisawa underscores that the missionaries faced some initial challenge, but succeeded ultimately in conveying the idea of the Creator. Even though the Japanese culture and the society of the Middle Ages did not have such a concept at all, we can see this in the words of the Bible, that the underground Christians, conveyed by oral means, it's called Tenji Hajimari no Koto, you see, thus we worship him who is the master of the heaven and the earth, appearance of human being and all things. Then he created 12 heavens, sun, moon, and stars. This also created all things and put soil, water, fire, wind, salt, oil, and warmth and flesh of his own into it. Totally, in 17 days in succession, this is what is called the human body. Here we see that the underground Christians consider their God, Deus, to have created everything in the universe. Although the story mixes in a Buddhist element to a certain degree. Concerning the idea of the Creator, Satomi Jinnai makes an interesting point based on a study of two writings by a Japanese rabbi who was once Jesse but abandoned his faith in the end. She concludes that it was only the idea of the Creator that was so persuasive for him that he could not deny. Indeed, Jinnai argues, he maintained this belief throughout his life, as was true of most Japanese Christians. If this is the case, then how did this kind of phenomenon occur? To address this question, I would like to focus on a study of by Chisato Kanda. He stresses the similarities between Deus and the idea of temple, which was traditionally regarded as meaning supernatural providence by the Japanese people. Thus, it is reasonable to suppose that the idea of temple was related to the acceptance of the concept of the Creator by Japanese people. Tento thought is characterized by its connection with natural phenomena, such as the connection between the astrological movement and the providence associated with Tento. For example, a natural disaster was regarded to present the anchor of Tento, acting as a warning to the administrator to whom Tento entrusted politics. The idea of the Creator Deus, example, although it was a totally new concept for the Japanese people, it should have been received positively because they would have recognized the relationship between divine providence and natural phenomena. That was also characteristic of Tento thought. Francisco Chavel reported in his letter that the Japanese asked him honestly about the natural phenomena. They are curious and asked many questions noisily. anxious to know. Their questions are not limited. They did not know that the earth is round, but the solar orbit is. They asked me these and other questions. For example, about metal, lightning, rain and snow, etc. As we replied and explained the answers to those questions, they were so satisfied to see that we are intellectual people. It is helpful to let them believe our stories. We should see these questions posed by the Japanese people not only as emerging from curiosity, but also as related to the idea of the creator, which Shabel explained to them. And when he replied to their questions, his explanation of the creator might have helped to persuade them. Later, he asked that any new missionaries who came to Japan should have a vast knowledge of natural phenomena. One of Japanese Jesuits, Manshu Ito, reported in 1594 that he was studying compendium, textbook written by Pedro Gomez, as you know, during the previous year at the Colegio in Amakusa. This book covered all the knowledge that Shabel had reported that Japanese people wanted to know. The missionaries took advantage of their European knowledge from a strategic perspective, and actually it worked. Having accepted the idea of the Creator, tied strongly to the concept of salvation, Japanese Christians held their faith dearly, sometimes to the point of martyrdom. Ebisawa studied the letters written by some martyrized Japanese samurais and emphasized that they understood the doctrine of redemption. Little is known, however, about what theories were held by ordinary people. In my opinion, the doctrine of redemption was not an essential element of Christianity for many Japanese people at that time. This does not mean, however, that they did not understand the doctrine at all. Some of them could have understood it through reading textbooks like Ondem's Mojo, Saint Russia, or from legends about saints, which the missionaries conveyed. For them, what was most important, however, was simply to believe it does, and it should have been reason enough to choose this in spite of apostasy. And the third topic is influence of the Christian missionaries in Japan. In this section, another question arises. How did people who accepted the idea of the Creator see the secular rulers? To answer this question, let's look at the letter written by Japanese Christians in 1621. To Pope Paul's view. This is not a good picture. Monochrome copy of the letter. In this, he says, we are living on the edge of the world of war, on this far off East Island, drowning in waves of error and disaster, tortured by the persecution of evil governments. But we received a letter from our pastor. We were sure that with the guidance of the general, we will reach the port of heaven smoothly. In fact, in this battlefield of Christianity, although we are beginners, we will beat the enemies through the orders of the general. We can see that Japanese Christians consider the rulers evil governments and enemies. The Pope, by contrast, was the general. Here, the influence of Christianity as a means to justify the logic of the established order is is observed strongly. For the Japanese governance, therefore, Christianity was nothing less than a dangerous new attempt to rule the people. This is why I refer to the impact of Christianity. The Tokugawa Bakufu was a military government. However, it needed an ideological policy to control the people, the Sakoku policy, closed country policy. Under the Sakoku system, Japanese people were forced to choose from the limited number of religions that were permitted by the Tokugawa regime. In conclusion, in Japan in the 16th and 17th centuries, a totally new situation emerged, caused by the formation of the world of religions. Christianity captured the hearts of many people and gave them different rules to live by or an outer sense of value, which went against the government. The rulers, therefore, have to create a new state system in Sakoku to support the power of Christianity increasing further in Japan. Recently, it has been recognized that the Sakoku policy bore marked similarities to the Kaikin policy formed in the Ming Dynasty. However, when we look at it from a contemporaneous perspective, Sakoku should be regarded as a political reaction to the formation of the world of religions, not as a policy found only in East Asia. Indeed, the reaction of Japan to the advancement of Christianity could be considered as similar to that of Ethiopia in this period. For Japan and for many other nations, the Christian missionaries offered an entrance into the world of the arts. They made a strong impact for better world. That's all my presentation. Thank you all.